It's KUT 90.5. I'm Jay Trachtenberg. We're downstairs in Studio 1A for some very special live music today. We're honored to have piano player Ramsey Lewis here live in Studio 1A. He's had a long, illustrious career that goes back to certainly having top 40 hits in the 1960s. You've recorded over 80 albums. You've had 7 gold records, 3 Grammys. You've won awards as a radio DJ in Chicago.
A radio personality, if you don't mind.
Okay, absolutely. And you're in town tomorrow night to do a couple of shows at the One World Theater.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that. We don't play Austin often enough, and so this is a pretty big deal for me.
Well, it's great. We're honored to have you both in Studio 1A and in our fair city.
Can we get you to
start off and play a number, and we can chat a little bit?
Yeah, this is a John Coltrane piece.
Great.
And it's called Dear Lord.
Ramsey Lewis live in Studio 1A, performing John Coltrane's tune, Dear Lord. Gospel music is in your roots.
Yeah, well, you know, when you start playing any style of music at 9 years old, it wasn't by choice. My father said, okay, you've been taking lessons since you were 4 years old. They say you're pretty good, so next week you're going to start playing for the church choir. And I did. And those are very impressionable years, from 9 through 16. And so the music definitely, not only the music, but, you know, the experience of being in an African-American church service, you know, where people did not hold back on their feelings.
Mm-hmm.
You experience this, and it just gets in your being.
And Chicago is probably the great gospel city in America.
The great gospel city in America, and I got to know Thomas A. Dorsey, who was one of the great gospel composers.
Right.
In fact, I still, to this day, play his famous Precious Lord song.
and you turned Wade in the Water into a top 40 hit.
Yeah, I almost forgot about that one. How could I forget about that one? We didn't play it like that in church, but it was, we were at a recording session, and I forgot who it was. The producer was Richard Evans, and he said, "Ramsey, you know that song you play, that's a church song, and I heard you play it in the club one night, but you kind of put a beat to it. Why don't you see what we can do?" So we recorded. He said, "Let me put some horns on it." Well, lo and behold, it became a hit record.
Right. So you're in town sort of revisiting your electric era back in the 1970s. Sun Goddess, you had an album that came out maybe, what, 6-8 months ago called Taking Another Look, where you revisited the Sun Goddess album, which came out in 1974. So what prompted you to go back to doing an electric thing, and then why did you revisit Sun Goddess in particular?
Good question. We were in Tokyo, and we were playing, the trio was playing there year before last, and we played Japan almost every year, and they were inviting us back the next year, and they said, "You know, if you want to bring an augmented band, or if you want to bring a singer, or if you want to come back with the trio," and then another guy there said, "Have you ever thought about getting your electric band back together?" And at that point, the trio had become so comfortable. In fact, I think it became too comfortable. It was sort of a comfort zone that when he said electric band, I'm like, in my being, I said, maybe not. To him, I said, "I'll think about it." Mm-hmm. But when I got home, my booking agent said, "That's a good idea." And my wife, Jan, she says, "Well, think about it. At least think about it." So this was close to the holidays, 2000, the year before last, 2010. Mm-hmm. And so it was too close to holidays to do anything. But I called some guys, including Henry Johnson, guitar. I said, "Right after the holidays, early January, we're going to get together and have a jam session because I want to see what this, and make sure the Fender Rhodes is there. I want to see what the electric thing feels like." And so they all asked me, "So what music should we think about?" So I said, "Well, everybody knows the songs on the Sun Goddess album. Mm-hmm. Kind of look at those songs, and that's what we'll jam on." Well, we did just that. Sometime in January, we got together, and we played those songs, and my God, they felt so good that I called the agent and right away, and I also called the record company and said, "I want to record this band in the next few weeks." And those are the songs we knew. Mm-hmm. We didn't know. So they said, "Well, you're recording some of the things you did before." I said, "Okay, we'll call it Taking Another Look." And the agent, being creative in marketing, says, "Call it the Sun Goddess Tour. We're going to call this tour the Sun Goddess Tour with Ramsey Lewis featuring his electric band." My son said, "If you're going to call the tour the Sun Goddess Tour, you got to have Sun Goddess on the album." I said, but he said, "I don't think you guys should try to sing it, though." So Maurice White allowed us to use their version on the album. So that's how that all came about.
And Maurice White, of course, a great drummer who was in your trio for many years and then went off to form Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Yeah. He, one day after rehearsal, he said, I'm going to probably leave in a few months and start my own group. And anybody who knows Maurice knows he's a very soft-spoken guy. And jazzer from way back, he played with Sonny Stitt, Gene Ammons, all the guys. Mm-hmm. So he's playing with me. I'm figuring, okay, he's going to start a little jazz quintet or something. And he says, "Oh, no. We're going to do magic. We're going to dance. We're going to play jazz, but we're going to play R&B, pop, rock." And I thought he was putting me on. I said, "Yeah, man, go home and take a nap. You'll sleep it off." One day, he told me, he says, "In the next 3 weeks," he called me and he says, "Well, I'm leaving the next week and I'm going to form this group." And there it was. So what happened, we were in the middle of recording an album. This is 4 years later, and maybe more than four or five years later. And they were in New York. Mm-hmm. And he says, "I have a song for you." And I said, "Great, because I'm in the studio now." He says, "Well, we're in New York. We're going to go back to L.A., but if you want, we'll stop by Chicago and help you with this song." He brought Philip, he brought Verdeen, and himself, of course. Oh, and Johnny Graham. Mm-hmm. He brought them. And so we worked on this song for a couple days. And he put the voices on, overdubbed the voices. "What's it called, Maurice?" "It's called Hot Dog It." "There you go. That's your hit record." And then sort of like he's almost out the door, he says, ah, we got this melody. It's a wonderful melody, Ramsey, you know. But there's nothing else to it. It's just a 16-bar melody. Mm-hmm. So I guess maybe everybody can just solo on it. And so we did that. It took us only a couple hours to do that. And I said, what are you going to call that? He hadn't thought about it at all. And then he said, call it Sun Goddess. If we put the album out, put the single out, Hot Dog It, the single mm-hmm. sold one or two copies, but the album started selling. And they told us the people were coming in asking for the album that had Sun Goddess on it.
And you're touring now playing music from Sun Goddess with your electric band.
Exactly.
And that'll be at the
Well, you know, not only playing music from that album, but now I've had time to write some new music. Mm-hmm. So when you come hear us, you'll not only hear us taking another look, but you'll hear us looking forward also.
All right. Well, would you like to do either a tune from either forward or backward?
Yeah, I can play this tune backwards. Well, not really.
Ramsey Lewis live in Studio 1A, here, there, and everywhere.
Right.
The Beatles. Now, you did Hard Day's Night also. You did some Beatles stuff in the 60s.
I think I'll start playing that again. Thanks for bringing it up.
People love that song.
Yeah, but that's why I did a Hard Day's Night and... was it? Oh, and I Love Her.
Right.
So we were playing those songs. So I liked some of the Beatles songs. And it was Charles Stepney who said, you should do a Beatles album. And I didn't know enough of those songs that I liked to do an album. He says, well, have you heard the White Album? Mm-hmm. Had not heard the White Album. Check it out. I checked it out and still I didn't hear enough where I... And so he said, would you trust me to do some arrangements of some of these songs and see how they feel before you just say no? Mm-hmm. I said, okay. I should have known he was going to come up with something unusual. His arrangements were great, and they fit our trio, so our trio could breathe and become a part of them. And now Mother Nature's Son, which is the name of the album, is one of the biggest albums I've ever recorded.
And Charles Stepney was a producer there with under the Chess umbrella.
Right.
Well, speaking of that, you recorded, I guess it was on Argo and Cadet, which was sort of subsidiaries of Chess Records. A lot of our listeners are familiar with Chess because of Muddy Waters and Little Walter and Howlin' Wolf and stuff. And you were recording for the label back then. What was that? Did you have any contact with kind of the blues people, or Etta James was big in those days?
Yeah, the Chess Brothers had a building and had a studio there, a couple studios in the building. Downstairs were offices. Upstairs were recording studios. And Etta James was always in and out of there. Muddy Waters was always in and out of there. Howlin' Wolf Later on, Ahmad Jamal, Ramsey Lewis, because at first they were just a blues, you know, Muddy Waters was their foundation.
Right.
And so they added on top of that. And then they got to the point where they said, well, let's see about jazz. And the first jazz artist, they did a single on Gene Ammons, Pennies from Heaven. And then after that, they did something with Ahmad Jamal at the Pershing. And each project they did got better and better, until they finally contacted us, and we became part of the family. But yeah, when you would go down there on any given day, you would see other artists walking around.
It's on South Michigan Avenue, right?
2120.
South Michigan Avenue, indeed.
Right.
So, that's when you had those top 40 hits. I remember hearing Hang On Sloopy and
Sloopy and
In Crowd, of course.
And
Wade in the Water was another one.
Right, right.
So, getting back to the electric period, for years, obviously, you're doing the piano trio, acoustic piano. So, what's it like now? Revisiting playing the Fender Rhodes, is that a whole different thing for you?
Well, you see, I didn't totally turn loose of the mother lode, which is the 9-foot concert Steinway grand piano. It is sitting there on stage with me, and right to the side there, right beside the Steinway, is the Fender Rhodes. So at this point, I have the best of all worlds, because not only do I have Henry Johnson playing electric guitar, but Henry was with me when I was playing jazz songs and other songs, so he knows my repertoire quite well. I have Joshua Ramos playing bass. He plays the electric bass as well as the upright bass, and he's versed in the foundation of our music, Charlie Parker and Oscar Peterson and all, but he's also, being 27 years old, into
young ideas.
Yeah, you know, and I have Charles Heath playing drums, and he's in his 30s, and so once again, he's not only versed in what jazz is all about and where it's coming from, but he's open to wherever I want to go. And finally, on keyboards, Tim Gant brought his synthesizers, and he's actually a piano player also. So I have a band where, yeah, we do a lot of electric stuff, but we've got arrangements now of stuff that I do as a trio. And sometimes they lay out and I play solo piano. This is something else that's become comfortable to me that I enjoy doing. So we go from playing solo piano to playing trio songs in a quintet manner, but then also having new quintet songs, as far as also having songs from the Sun Goddess album. So we have quite a repertoire at the moment.
And our listeners have a couple of opportunities to see you tomorrow night at the One World Theater. There's an early show at 7 and one at 9:30 at the One World. It's a beautiful theater, and it's intimate, a great place to hear jazz. So are there any young pianists coming up that you listen to that you recommend that you enjoy hearing?
Yeah, you know, I don't remember a lot of names, but as I travel, one of the dilemmas in our business at the moment, I hear young piano players, young musicians in general, on the East Coast, on the West Coast, in Chicago, and other places, and I'm sure here in Austin, that have put the work in, have seriously practiced, but places to perform. There used to be in Chicago, when I was coming up, 10 or 12 places on the West side. There's a couple dozen places throughout the city that local boy can go play for a couple bucks or whatever it is and learn what it is to play in front of an audience. And that's what it is. That's what it takes to get to Carnegie Hall. They tell you practice, practice, practice if you want to get to Carnegie Hall. Well, not only practice, practice, but you got to practice performing. You got to learn what it is and how it feels, and how you practice hard all day and all night for several weeks, and when you get in front of an audience, something happens. The chemistry of all these eyeballs on you and the stuff that you figured you really had down pat, and there's certain people looking at you like, yeah, well, let me see what you really got. It's different. You got to get used to that, to learn how to maintain what you're about, who you're about, and what you intend for them to feel. not what they're making you feel, which is that mm-hmm. when at first it's kind of nervous. You got to learn what that's about. You got to learn what professional anxiety is about. What is that? When you're waiting in the wings and it's just 2 or 3 seconds before they're going to announce your name, there's that feeling of take a deep breath and go out there. You learn how to do all that. Mm-hmm. But you got to learn by performing in front of people. So I don't know. I got to talk to some huge corporations that have a ton of money to start opening some places for young people out of high school, college, especially college, to be heard so that they can develop into Herbie Hancock, develop into Wayne Shorter, develop into, and you only do that by performing.
Ramsey Lewis is here with us, gracing us with his presence. He's at the One World Theater tomorrow night. We get you to do one more?
I don't know if I know 3 songs.
Ramsey Lewis, live in Studio 1A. Well, thank you so much for coming in and giving us your time and playing on our piano. And
it was fun. And great, fun talking with you.
Greatly appreciate it. Cliff Hargrove is our engineer. I'm Jay Trachtenberg. We're going to go out with a tune from Sun Goddess, the Stevie Wonder cover, Living for the City. Anything you want to say, set
that
up for us?
That's one of the songs that we jammed on before we put this band together. And it went so well, that's one of the reasons we put the electric band back together.
And this song was really popular right before you recorded Sun Goddess back in the day.
That's right. Well, Stevie Wonder was important to me because he wrote 2 or 3 songs just for, first for my trio, and then later songs for a bigger group. And I like his music anyway.
Here's Ramsey Lewis from the classic album Sun Goddess, performing Stevie Wonder's Living for the City. Once again, Ramsey Lewis and his electric band tomorrow night, 2 shows at the One World Theater, 1 at 7, 1 at 9:30. Thank you, Ramsey Lewis. It's KUT 90.5.